change that too. We've got some idea of where the need is and what the scale of the issue is. But it seems to have that moment.
Thank you, Moira. Christina. From the environment screening committee, we're doing this work on Montessori. And what we have discovered is that it affects all walks of life. You can't compartmentalise it. And it's going on all the time. It's going unnoticed. That's how it's happening. So I kind of think we need something altogether across all local authorities, between all groups. Otherwise, you're never going to see it. You've discovered that the one case that went to court was through a neighbour noticing on the map. So it's how the meetings and how the reports we have are not going to solve that problem. That's my view.
I think what I want to say is we don't want to wait until we get to the next meeting with Sue coming here for her to be cognizant of the issues that are being raised. So I have to give assurances that what points are raised today that are not yet dealt with in terms of the report or my responses, I'll take that to Sue.
Okay. So I'm pleased with what you said. I feel I want to emphasise, yes. Beyond that, is that we think it's a best everybody. It's not just a safeguarding issue, it's not just a whatever issue, because there are too many aspects to it and too many people who come to face with it and don't realise. We have a very interesting discussion with environmental health who play a big part. And we know that other people do, if we're all going to do, without noticing. So that's where the training and everything comes in, doesn't it? Awareness comes in. So whilst I'm pleased and I accept what you're saying, I do think we all have to be aware that it's happening, and it's going to be very hard to find out where and how.
Can I suggest that that might be something that we build into the members training program initially? That's set in place to run, but we haven't particularly built it for the training plan for the students.
Yeah. Thank you.
There is some labour on the point, I do apologise, but I think Councillor Parker and Councillor Scott made a very valid point here, and I think I understand where you're coming from with regards to being part of a broader attention seeking department, but in fairness, this is a serious matter. I mean, we demand a lot of data capture from businesses around modern day slavery, and I don't see why we can't be doing something that we see as a people on this matter. I think it's so important, it probably needs to be taken out, if I'm being honest, out of the sort of general people vulnerability. And if we're not doing it, we're a bit behind the ball with the council.
Absolutely. So we are aware that the protocols, etc., that come from the government, but they don't actually help the situation on the ground and the ability of staff and others to know what it is they're seeing. And that's whether you then drive it in or underground, we don't know. But it's an area which everybody can produce documentation of, but what is actually happening, and that's the part of the reason, certainly those of us on our screen.
Thank you.
So, yes.
Can I Tracey.
Actually, a year or so ago, when safeguarding was being discussed, maybe Atkinson and key people were concerned about funding. It would be fair to say that in order to ensure continuity of services, various senior people had to ensure that there was a package of funding that enabled continued work to take place. Because of now in the combined or in the combined, we would perhaps lose some oversight of assurance that there is a continuing funding stream in place, ensure that there's a team of people with experience to ensure that there's a backup. so that the new body, with its own individual identity, whatever, we might lose some sight of. So it needs some assurances that there is to be continued, almost guaranteed funding at a level that enables the work to carry on for future years.
Okay.
Can I respond to that?
Yes.
I mean, at this stage, we have a budget that's based on those partner contributions, which is more significant in its collective for the four areas than we had previously. What we're aiming to do in terms of using that to full effect is to look at the kind of best practice models around the resource development, particularly to where there are issues around particular themed concerns, like modern slavery, like prevent. There is a clear plan for how we deliver training, multi-agency in that area. And the national model is a four-tiered one, basic awareness, working together type approaches, the more specialist areas of new concerns or complex concerns, and then training for the board itself. And so that the board will seek to, you know, to be assured that that's being delivered across the areas sufficiently.
Opportunity to develop a single point of access for health and social care in the community. So in June 17, we implemented this new service model, and under this new arrangement, the community trust provide the adult social care secretary duties for older people and adults on behalf of the council under a contract arrangement. So progress so far since June 17, so about 6 months in, we had a very robust planning stage up to the transfer, and we aimed for a safe transfer of about 240 staff into the employment of the community trust with as little disruption as possible for people that use the services. We did achieve that. People who received the services were communicated with in advance of the transfer and were not aware of any service users that experienced any disruption to their care arrangements as a result of this. Equally, staff found it a relatively smooth transfer, and staff appreciated the warm welcome extended to the wider trust. There was a very well-received welcome event at St. Catherine's Hospital that most of the staff attended, and that was received very well by staff that transferred. Many of the fundamental issues like information technology, systems, all of that was well planned, and the changeover happened quite quickly and quite smoothly for staff. So we didn't receive didn't experience any major problems with that. So in terms of the delivery of the service, we have regular contract monitoring meetings and quality assurance meetings through the Partnership Governance Board to keep a regular oversight of the delivery. And it's a very transparent relationship that we have, and the trust have embraced the requirements to report and to produce records and updates on the performance indicators and so on in line with the contract. And the trust have very much embraced this and are committed to both delivering the quality service but also improving quality as we go forward. So the second quarterly contract review meeting that we had, we did notice that overall performance have been generally sustained at the same level or above the level of performance at the point of transfer. And we saw some sustained small incremental improvements in some areas around the times taken to undertake assessments and handle incoming referrals and complete reviews on time and so on. We've also noticed some very effective management of allocation lists within teams, the way the teams handle their duty arrangements. So we are starting to see some early signs of benefits for people in achieving a more coordinated and more responsive service. Safeguarding duties have been delivered very effectively. We have some issues around timescales for completing investigations within the 28 time period that was a target. We still continue to work on improvements in that regard, and we have seen some improvements. In terms of complaints, we haven't received any complaints in relation to the transfer itself, and the number of complaints for social care activity delivered by the trust have been a small in number, and similar themes to what we are used to seeing on the previous part of the transfer. We've seen a very proactive approach from the trust in terms of staff development and professional standards, and we have seen a number of social workers progressing through the social work career framework as was intended, and there hasn't been any kind of adverse effect or slowdown in the rate of staff progressing through professional development. So that's been a positive. And we've had some very positive feedback from service users and from staff, which I will come on to now. So from the council's perspective, we believe this service is going very well and that we see early signs of incremental improvement. It's a long-term relationship, it's early days, but we think it's going very well. So perhaps I'll hand over to Colin.
Yes. I think that it's really, really important that we did this as a double act. Jason mentioned what we wanted to get some of the benefits from the transfer, and there's a lovely quote on the bottom of page 5 that we received from Associates that he was pleased to get, that did get to pass from pillar to post, and that that person only has one word to deal with. And thank you, as it reduces that person's stress. And I think that's really important because it was one of our benchmarks that we wanted to achieve when we transferred this over. I'll not go into the case study that's on page 6, you can read that yourself. What we wanted to do from the very beginning was to recognise that it was a large transfer, and that we wanted to make sure that effective governance arrangements were in place. So that we had a safe transfer. And so we developed a 100-day plan. I think this has been shown to cabinet members as well. And that showed the key priorities that we wanted to do in that first 100 days. And that was really about services transfer in a very safe way. And the 100-day plan is in the pack as well. Also, we were very clear that we were taking into our organisation a set of services and staff with different skills that are none of our staff or our board or our government or anybody on this had ever an experience before. And we wanted to make sure that the staff that came across felt that they had a line of sight from the work they were doing at the front line up to the board. So we appointed an associate director of social care, and that person is goes into all of our committee meetings and is that IEA from the ground to the board, and I think it's really important that we make that statement and make that improvement. Social care staff are integrated into our leadership programme. So I was very, very clear that when the staff came across, we didn't have a separate directorate for adult social care. We wanted them to integrate and be part of the services that we already have. And therefore, all of the staff have access to all of the leadership and development programmes that we have within the trust. At the same time, we wanted to make sure that all of the staff standards and professional standards were linked into the trust, but also how it fed back into the partnership governance board, which Councillor Jones chairs. And we had a meeting only last week, and that was received very favourably. HR and engagement. Jason's already mentioned about the successful transfer and the engagement event on the 1st of June. It was an absolute delight to be there on that day. Everybody was really, really pleased to come into the organisation, so our staff were very pleased to receive them as well. Because it felt joyous, if that's the only way to describe it. It was really lovely. The staff are now being part of our appraisal process, so again, they're linked into the appraisal process that any of the health staff currently access. And the thing that I'd just like to finish on, a quote that we got from staff and again this morning in the pack, but staff felt that they were welcomed with open arms and are considered a valuable asset to the trust. And another one felt that they were already encouraging better integration into their business and social care. And that goes back to the ethos that we wanted to have, patients that only told the story once, services and people. We only tell the story once, and that we have one single access into the service. We know we've still got a lot of work to do. It is early days. Some of the work that we want to do around having a single assessment process, having a single care record, all of that will come. But the first 6 months, I think we made a lot of good progress. Not only the services that we deliver, but the way that people feel about our services and the way that staff feel working in our services. I think it's a really good start point. And we just welcome the opportunities that we've got to work with commissioners going forward to improve the services even more.
Okay, thank you, Mark and Jason. A number of hands gone up straight away. Christina, Moira, Wendy, and Tony.
Thank you. I think it might be to you now on 5.3. I don't quite understand your example, because why could the OT team have decided on a new bed rails? Why did it need all these people going for a meeting? Surely it was an OT issue at that point.
It was. Well, what we start the process of is with an MDT, so we have a number of different professionals at the meeting. who then decide which of the best professionals to take that piece of the work forward, and that is why the OT is there to
it. Just seems to me that you have a meeting for meeting's sake there, because the OT will be able to tell you if they have equipment that they can Skype it and say, this is what's here, this is what happened, what do you suggest? It's the OT's job, surely, to say what the best is. And then why would the nurse decide?
Well, what we want to do is we want to get to a position, and I think this is the start of it, where we have one person who does the initial assessment, and they do that on behalf of a range of professionals, and then they would pull in the most appropriate specialist part of that assessment.
Well, then why did you go to contact OT right away? It seems to me that we're de-skilling, aren't they?
Well, I don't think we will, because I think what we'll do, because I think we need to work towards a generic assessment process, and then we then pull in those skills. So what we do skill, we'll actually add to people's skill set.
You are doing skilling, I think, and I can't see why you would have all those people there, because Chris, the OT would tell you that, wouldn't they?
Could I just say, I've written here, I've seen it a different way to you, in that I've said, I think it's a great example of working together in the best interests of the patient.
Right. Well, so thank you, Chair, for interrupting me, but the point I'm making is you seem to be including an awful lot of people who could be away doing something else.
Could I perhaps respond to that?
Yes,
I think in this instance, this links to the integrated community equipment service, and I think in this case, it was actually the nurse that was involved in the case that was able to prescribe the bed rails in the first place without having to go through a separate OT assessment. So I think in this case, the social care worker was able to speak directly with the nurse that had responsibility for arranging that equipment and then resolve it between themselves.
So what you're actually saying is the wrong person made the decision in the first place, that we had to have all these other people drilled in. Because you're saying that the bed rails were wrong in the first place because the wrong person made the decision.
Okay,
could I think
we move forward, Moira? Yeah, thanks. I'd like to make a different point if we don't mind. First of all, thanks very much for this report, and I know it's one series that we've had, and I think this committee over quite a long period now has made the point on several occasions that we now need to move towards a more integrated service that will bring benefits for those who use the service. So thank you for this report, and I know there's a lot of planning, very detailed planning for everyone to get into this stage, shall I? The one area I'd just like to ask you about is Council's got some statutory duties and responsibilities and they're delegated. Can you tell me how you're managing the risks of that?
So we have a range of governance meetings where we look at all of the different aspects of what our governance should be. But we're very clear that the overall statutory responsibilities range. And we work very closely with the principal officer and the principal social worker professional standards. And they work very closely with our governance team as well. And our associate director is the person who looks at that from an umbrella perspective. So we're very clear about who's
where the governance range is in place. I'm just wondering how, if push comes to shove and there's an issue, how that will be dealt with.
We've worked together on this, so we've got a close relationship between the principal social worker role and managers in the service around that continuous professional development and professional standards. The principal social worker role that's retained within the council also oversees an audit process, and various subjects are identified for audit as a programme of audit for the year. So some deep dive into case records, decision making, and it's good to monitor that basis as well.
In terms of accountability is why myself and the council like the operational delivery is going to provide. So we've created the performance and quality framework, which is quite a tight framework. The key difference here is rather than managing the service directly, else it's managing the service on behalf of, and the commission being clear about what quality standards are.
Thanks.
Thank you, Wendy.
Thanks, Chair. I was pleased that can see that it's making a big difference, and also just how hard you will work to get to the place you're at. So I've got two questions with your indulgence, Chair. One is to ask you, I think you touched on it, Val, about the challenges for the service now you've passed that initial stage. What are you looking at on the horizon and doing that equally detailed work on to get it right? And it's just a phrase on the bottom of page 54. It talks about contributing positively to demand management. That's your page 8, 6.4. Contributing positively to demand management. I suppose my question is, what does that feel like if I'm a person or a relative of somebody who needs care?
So, suppose it goes back a little bit to the point that Christine was making, that we are in this phase at the moment where we, you know, we're trying to understand the different roles, we're trying to understand which skills from which professional we need to allocate attention to. So it is early days, but we believe that as we start to really understand each other's roles a bit more, then we can bring together those services and manage the demand in a much more collaborative way, so that we're doing it in a more efficient, basically. And to do that, we know that we need to move on to the next phase. So we've got staff co-located, you've seen that. We already know that we've got benefits just from having a discussion about a case in the same building. And so therefore, if we do need to send out two people because we want to do an assessment, we can do that. Or we can pass information on so that the person that's doing that assessment has got more information to take. So we know we're already starting to bring together the services in a much better way, but we can then start to think about how we manage some of that demand. One of the things that we have said is that when we start to realise those efficiencies by working much more collaboratively, so having things like the trusted assessor role or having a simple assessment process, some of that the efficiency savings will be ploughed back into the service so we can then manage the demand that we know we will be facing together over the next few years. So there's something about we do that collaboratively with our commission colleagues.
Thank you, Jeremy.
I just wanted to ask, thanks for your report, and that was really comprehensive. Just aware of when I was pupils in the children's services, I felt the quality of the reports and the information we received was really enhanced when we received a trade union report from the staff, and it was what you were talking about, Val, it's that front line to the workforce, if you like, and how that's going. I'm always a little bit maybe suspicious when we get reports like this, which is really, really positive. So it's all the comments and what have you are all positive. There's nothing in there that's negative or anything like that. So that raises my suspicion a little bit, you know. So I just feel that the quality of the information, because I know in the children's services, we did retrospectively receive a trade union report, and that did highlight some of the issues that maybe weren't reported at committees previously. Would that be possible?
Well, I don't have any objections to that, but I'd like to offer you a visit as well, so that you can come and ask people, and you would be very welcome. Anybody would be very welcome, as Wendy's already done. I think that, you know, you're right, you have put a very positive approach to it, but then that's how we've been feeling it.
Yeah.
Very, very quickly, after the staff transfer, I made sure that I went round to every staff base to welcome each of the teams, as well as the welcome event. And said to the guys there, if there's anything, then just let us know, because we understood straight away that it was a very anxiety for both the town staff, and that we needed to feel that, you know, they were part of an organisation that really wanted them to be there, because we felt that it would make a big difference. And that has been the message that we've been giving all along. And also all of the staff are infiltrated into all of our processes that go on. And I'm sure, you know, that as time goes on, you know, you'll start to hear, you know, perhaps, you know, a different perspective. But at the moment it's very, very positive.
Yeah.
For example, one of the staff groups asked whether they could have their name changed because they thought it was confusing with welcome and listening to them, and the more that we do that, the more confidence they'll have that they'll be listened to and we'll move on. But anybody's very welcome to come and see us.
I'm very pleased with your answer, you know, and the fact that you're willing to bring a training report, and I do accept your invitation for the visit. That's fantastic. Cheers.
Okay, thank you, Phil.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sure. It's sometimes, and sorry, it's to the Eastern Bank as well. My old colleagues were to change my systems work as well, meeting staff. I really want to ask about this issue of the future and the single care record. As to what it takes to actually get it in place. But it's an ancient system in my mind of information being transported from hospitals to doctors to being fed in various forms and people trying to make sense of all the information coming in order to build up a package. So I'm just wondering what we should expect or hope to see and how long it might take to just devise it.
So I suppose there's a couple of things on this. We agreed as part of the transfer that we will continue to use Logic, which is the council's record system. And we have opportunities where some of our staff can access both what we use in our health system, System 1, and the Logic. So we're doing that internally. But as far as the work that we're doing on the Wirral care record, there's a lot of work going on as part of the Healthy Wirral group. So we know that the hospital and the GP practices have got access to each other's information. We've also started to make we've already had the connections with the community information, and some of that information has just been starting to be passed over in the last few weeks. So we're starting to build up a picture of what some of these information about their history is within those different components. Because we've known all along that you can never afford one IT system for Wirral, so we've had to work with connecting the current systems that we have, which we've probably got 6 or 7. So there is a programme from a Healthy Wirral perspective to get that single care record, where people will be able to read the information on their past connections and interfaces with whichever part of the system they're doing. But we're probably 2 or 3 years away from that, is it?
Well, I'm not actually currently working on such yet, closely, but as you say, I do know that the rollout of the component where GPs can view hospital records is throughout all, and now there are connections to the actual Wirral care record in each practice, so it's now rolling out, and I believe the community trust are the next.
We started to national to
join. So it's an iterative process to pull it together so that the appropriate information before staff go out to do an assessment gives them as much background information as is appropriate.
Okay, there's no further questions. Can I just ask that the committee report on a very detailed report? Can I ask how the members who joined to take your photographs along and visit what's going on? How we can coordinate that?
So they just came through to our trustful offices and asked to speak to my PA.
The budget workshop that we had. Now, this was presented to us by Graham, as the Director of Health and Care, and provided us all an overview of the current budget composition. We looked at current budget risks and pressures, and obviously recognised that although the overall budget has been increased, we still have a gap, and there's a series of measures that Graham explained to us that were designed to ensure that we managed the demand. So unless anybody's got questions on that, because I know we were all at that presentation, then I ask that we note that, please, and move on. So now moving on to item number 9, the work programme update. If I can just draw your attention to our next special meeting, which is on Tuesday the 13th of February. I'm going to have a look there at the local delivery of the 5-year forward view, which I think, given that we have quite a heavy work programme, we felt that we wanted to take that separately. It's quite a heavy item, so we're going to look at that on its own. And Simon has kindly volunteered to take us through that again, along with Matthew, I believe.
I'll be in attendance.
Oh, it's Bell Pickle. Okay. Okay. And will
be Andrew
Gibson as well?
No, it's Mel that's coming on. Okay. So it's in that which will be nice. But she will be briefed in a class session.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Can I just, this doesn't quite come into any of business. I was looking at the.
Are we still on the item 9, is it?
Sorry, yes.
Yeah. It's okay to start. You've got the Universal Credit Scrutiny workshops and what have you. It does state that that's going to start happening in February. Do you have any dates for that and what have you? Because it's, you know, just linking to impact assessments on those people, you know.
Yeah, it's going to be a joint workshop. It is with business, and it's actually a note that I put down as well. We could do with the date for that, please.
The dates haven't been finally agreed yet, but there will be plans to be a couple of workshops. I think one will be a week commencing the afternoon 19th, and then one just been following the week as well. One of my colleagues is working on that, and he'll contact members. Because the idea is to invite members of the four scrutiny committees to both of those sessions.
Will they be happening in the daytime?
No, they'll be early in the evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. When the spokesperson of what we met recently, this list was updated for the 20th of March, because we discussed on the side that there should be a report which gives us some confidence and satisfaction that everything will be in place for a full release to the Walton Centre that promised from May, and that if we had on the 20th of March as a progress report that gave us that assurance that the staff were being trained, that everything was on target.
Okay. Yes.
Thank
you. Do you have questions? If I can note that we accept that work programme there, and we move on. Could I ask if there was any in business? There is one item that I want to bring up, there is one item that I wanted to note, and I'm trying to see where I've written it. I was something to it was actually looking at the budget proposals, and it was the increase in demand for acute hospital services. And what I realised is that actually we haven't picked that up. I'm hearing so much about the winter pressures in hospitals, and it's something that I would like to pick up as a scrutiny committee. And I think that it might be a time to actually look at reintroducing the healthcare panel so that we can actually have a look at in more detail this sort of scrutiny. Christina, did you want to say something on that?
No,
sorry.
I want to say something on something else.
Okay. No, I'll just take Moira then if I can, and then bring you in Christina.
I would like to see that panel reintroduced as well. I do feel a bit of a gap in our work this year, we just have got to agree on that area, and I think that was a good way of doing it. It was a panel rather than like a subcommittee, because it was formal arena, and it was it gave the ability to really dig into what was going on. And I would like to do that.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Christina.
Yes, on page 79, where the following. Why is future commissioning strategy being moved to this improvement?
Where's that, Christine, sorry?
On page 79, the proposed agenda items.
No comment.
Yes, I mean, I think it's